I hope everyone is enjoying the conference so far. So some really good sessions. And so today we're going to talk about migrating your messaging workloads to the cloud. And we are going to see how we can use Azure Service Bus for this. So a little bit about myself. I'm El Schotenboer. I come from Netherlands, but these days I live in Vancouver. So I'm the program manager on Service Bus in the Seattle team. I'm myself still in Vancouver. Hopefully in a year or two, I'm also in Seattle. If you have any questions, if you have any remarks, you can always contact me on Twitter, on my email. And with that, let's have a look at what actually is Azure Messaging. So who here already works with messaging services? Yeah. So why do we use messaging services? Because messaging is essential in modern architectures. Messaging allows us to work asynchronously. We can have our sender and receiver decoupled. So we have that loose coupling where our sender doesn't need to know about our receiver and they can work independently from each other. It's about responsiveness. If I have many senders and my receiver cannot keep up, I can just place it in a queue and it will still respond to the front end. And in meanwhile, my backend workers can just work on that load. And this allows us to have scalability, and that's really important. So if we look at messaging in Azure, we basically have five different services that we can use. First of all, we have storage queues. And storage queues are really about simple tasks. It's really like, okay, I need something in between where I can just put in a message, the other side picks it up. Very scalable, but very simple. For enterprise messaging, and that's the one we're going to talk about today, we have Service Bus. So Service Bus has queues and topics, and it also has a lot more features than, for example, storage queues. It's really about enterprise messaging, where I can have deduplication, poison messaging handling. We will see a lot of them later on, so I'm not going to go too deep into that one now. So Event Grid is for eventing. So the difference between messaging and eventing, messaging, I want the other application to do something, create an invoice, purchase an order. So I have an intent and an expectation out of this. Where an event is about, hey, something happened. If someone is interested, here's what happened. And that part is where Event Grid comes in. So it's really about events, where I can just push out my events and anyone that wants to subscribe to them can subscribe to them and do something with that event. Then we have Event Hubs, which is also about events, but unlike Event Grid, which is about single events. So, hey, someone turned on the thermostat or something like that. Event Hubs is about streaming data. So think more like Kafka. So if I turn on the thermostat, that will be an event. If I say, hey, it's now 20 degrees, 20.1 degrees, 20.2 degrees, 20.1 degrees, that's a stream of data. So that's the difference between Event Grid and Event Hubs. And finally, we have Relay, which is our secure sockets, where we can basically expose any web service that's behind the firewall to Azure, to the public internet, without any firewall configurations. And that just makes it very easy to expose those sockets over the internet. So quick slide on numbers. So these are from last month, which I pulled out. So over the last month in Service Bus Premium, we did 2.9 trillion messages. So that's the amount of messages per month. We did this with 4 nines and 3s. So, and for those that were in the previous session about the chaos testing, like these are pretty good numbers, I would say. Which still means that though, if from those 2.9 trillion messages, we still have quite a few that run into some kind of error. The good thing though is this is our internal failure, like our internal success rate. If you use our SDKs, you will not notice these failures. This might be a cluster that's being upgraded. It might be a connection that dropped. If you use SDKs, we have a lot of technology in there, a lot of retries, making sure connections get reestablished and things like that. So you, if, as a user, will not see this number. You will see even like many more nines. Now, this is premium. So we have basically three tiers. We have Service Bus Basic, Standard, and Premium. Premium is the one that we're going to focus on mostly today, which has all the nice goodies like VNet integration, JMS that we're talking about today. But we also have Basic and Standard, which are more for your, as it says, your basic scenarios with messaging, where you don't need like your own hardware, your own integrations and stuff like that. And there we still have 167 trillion messages per month. So as you can see, there's a lot of messages going on there. And there we have a 99.999% success rate. Below this, just a bit more numbers for all the messaging services. We are in tier one service, so we are in all the regions. 100% of the top 500 customers use our services. We run on 70,000 VMs, so there's a lot of hardware powering our messages. And 266 petabytes per month through the Service Bus Basic and Standard. But just to give you a bit of an idea, like what are the how much message do we actually handle as Service Bus? As you can see, it's quite a bit. So about Azure Service Bus. So here already use Azure Service Bus. So a few people, so just a quick introduction here as well, just to make sure that you're all on the same page. So Azure Service Bus is a platform as a service, queue, and PubSub message broker. So what does this mean? It basically means you have queues. So I put something in, someone else picks it up and processes it. And I have PubSub, where I put something in, and I can create filters and do routing of those messages to zero to multiple subscribers. It's fully managed, it's a complete PaaS service. You don't care about hardware, you just care about, hey, I have messages that I want to put somewhere. So it's completely managed for you. We make sure that everything keeps on running. JMS 2.0 compliant, which we're going to have a look at today. It's also AMQP 1.0 compliant. So we fully support those standards. So this also means that you can very easily interchange this with other message brokers. We support the many different languages with SDKs. We are completely cross-platform, so if no matter where you are running, no matter what language you're on, you're probably okay with on Service Bus. Of course, industry leading reliability, availability, as I just showed you with the numbers, like we actually make sure that your messages are saved, that your messages will be processed, because we know that your messages are important. Our customers are running very high workloads on this, very expensive workloads sometimes, like we have banks on there, we have the stock markets on there. Like we know that these messages are very important, so we make sure that you will always be having these messages when you expect them. And of course, this is in Azure, so if you're in Azure, it nicely integrates with all the other different services, like Event Grid, Logic Apps, Functions, Power Platform. It's all very easy to integrate. And I already said in the beginning that Service Bus is enterprise messaging as a service. And what that means is, like I said, we have queues and topics. So we can both do queuing, but also that public subscribe with filtering, with routing. It's really reliable because, like I said, it's really important for us that your messages will never be lost. You can add message headers. So this is one of those features that, for example, storage queues does not support up to a point, but not like we go a bit farther with this. So you can add message headers. On those message headers, you do your routing and filtering. So if you, for example, say, well, I have two warehouses, one in North America, one in the EU. I want to make sure that the messages go to the right warehouse so they will be picked where they should be going. So you can do this with that kind of routing and filtering, which I also have a demo of later on. And it's all about, we have rich features which really make that enterprise messaging a thing. So like I said, we have pointer message handling, dead lettering, VNet integration, all those features that you really want in the enterprise. And like I said, we have three different tiers. So we have basic, which is really just queues and schedule messages up to 256 kilobytes. We mostly see this for some like smaller workloads where it's just like, okay, I just need to make sure that my systems are decoupled. But most of our customers we see either on standard or premium. So standard also gives those topics with that public subscribe. It gives kind of transactions, deduplication, sessions, forward to. As you can see, we already do a lot of things there. But if you really want to have like all that enterprise and if you really care about your messages, you will probably want to be on premium. Because premium is where we do our VNet integration, for example. We do our geodisaster recovery there. We have JMS support. We have availability support, availability zone support. So as you can see, premium is really where we bring all the goodies in. And just because I know some people will say, well, premium is kind of expensive. If you calculate, if you run about 100 messages per second through your workload, like on average, premium is actually cheaper. So of course there is definitely like a tipping point where standard will be cheaper over premium. But if you really want to have all those nice features, we definitely tell you to go to premium because that is where we will implement all these extra things that are more for the enterprise, more for if you're really running the more important workloads. And one very important thing is we now support up to 100 megabytes. We used to be one megabyte. But because of JMS that I'm going to talk about today, JMS with other MQ providers often would have large messages. So we actually upped this to 100 megabytes and also did some performance improvements here. So this is still very fast if you use this. Like I said, we support many different SDKs. So of course we support the .NET, like, and everyone would have expected Microsoft to support the .NET. But we also support Java, we support Spring Boot, we support Python, we support JavaScript and TypeScript, we support Go. So as you can see, we have many different SDKs so that you can bring your workload without having to change to .NET or anything like that. You just work in the language that you want on the platform that you want. So a bit more about JMS, and this is where the session will really be about, basically like our JMS support. And for those that don't know JMS, JMS is really the protocol in the Java market. It's very mature, it's lowest denominator, sorry. 1.0 was released in 1998, so already quite a while back. 2.0 was released in 2013, which is what about, so we support 1.1 and 2.0. And recently, 3.0 was released this year, so we're also going to look into that. And like I said, it's really the lowest common denominator. Like every Java application has support for JMS, all the different MQ products out there, like ActiveMQ, IBM MQ, Artemis, WebSphere, they all support this. And so we thought it was important that we should also support this. So it's very mature. It's been being used by a lot of different companies. And like I said, many commercial, but also open source implementations. Now, if you're already running JMS in your own data center or at a hosted location, we think that you should move to Azure Service Bus. And of course, I say this not just as program manager of Azure Service Bus, but I come from a consultancy background. I've been working with many different clients around this. So I know both the side of actually the product itself, but also from the customer side. And Azure Service Bus really is more reliable. I've seen too many customers that were like, no, we want to manage our own hardware because then we're in control. But in the end, if you look at the uptime of your own data center, it's really hard to beat Azure on that part. Like, if you want to have that uptime that we have, like we are running, your messages are being stored in three different places every time. If you use availability zones, actually in three different data centers, if you use GDPR, it will actually be around the world. That kind of reliability is really hard to accomplish on yourself. It's less costly to own, and for anyone that has ever done something with IBM MQ knows that IBM MQ is very expensive. Some of the other providers are also quite expensive. Where Service Bus, for the premium, for one messaging unit, you pay about $600 per month. So it's lots less expensive than actually have to go out, buy those IBM licenses, buy your Windows license, and all that kind of stuff. It's less costly to operate because, like I said, you don't manage your hardware. We manage that for you. You just take the servers and work with it. You don't have to care about everything that's underneath that. We take care of that. So you don't have to have administrators that take care of you for that for you. It's milliseconds away from your existing workloads. Of course, we integrate with everything in Azure. But also, you can very easily integrate this into your own network. You can use VNet integration with VPN gateway or ExpressRoute. And so even if your workload might still be partly on-prem, like in a hybrid scenario, you can still actually interact with those systems and make sure that you are with near your workloads on a less expensive service that handles a lot for you that you don't have to handle yourself anymore. So using JMS with Azure Service Bus, like I said, we support both JMS 1.1. Although this one we don't fully support. We just support a limited feature set on this. And this is on the standard tier. But this is more just like, okay, I just have that very simple model where I just have a JMS queue where I want to put something in, I want to get something out, like just that simple model. We support JMS 1.1 for that one on standard tier. But where most of our effort is in JMS 2.0, also because this was the latest, like I said, they just released 3.0, so we're going to support that one as well. But for now, 2.0 is the one that we see most with most of our customers. There's most asked for this. And this is also on the premium tier, so you also get all that nice feature set that the premium tier brings. So like I said, we support large messages. This is quite important for many MQ workloads. But first of all, we support both Java and Spring. So if you're on the Java stack, we support that with the JSDK. But also for Spring Boot, we also support that. And I will show a demo of both of these. And what is really nice, we have a seamless migration. So it's literally just change your configuration, which I will show you in a minute how easy this is. But it's literally just change your configuration, everything will work. Your existing workloads don't need to be changed. They can just be as they are, and you can just go over. Of course, it works with all the enterprise connectors. So of course, in Azure, like with logic gaps and stuff like that. But also, for example, with SAP. You can just change your configuration in SAP, and it will just work without having to change anything else. And like I said, up to 100 megabytes, because we know that a lot of these workloads will actually have larger messages. We do still think that 100 megabytes is a lot for a message, because at that point, are you really sending a message or are you just doing like a system dump? But if you want to do those large messages, we can actually support those as well. So the JMS 2.0 provider, what do we support? We support, I think about at the moment, we support 95% of the feature set of JMS 2.0. There's one or two features that we are still working on that will be coming soon. And then we will be 100% compliant. I'm not going to run through all of them. Like, you can read them if you want. But what's most important is that we actually do support all of these features. So you can actually just move your application, point to the Service Bus, and it will just work. And like I said, there's no need for any code changes. So this will work both if you're working with ActiveMQ or IBM MQ or with Service Bus. And same, of course, for sending messages. Like I said, nothing has to change in your actual code except for your configuration, which we'll see in just a moment. So if you're going to migrate, how do we do this? So first of all, we take our existing application. So this can be a Java application, a Spring application. You just take your existing application. You get the Azure Service Bus JMS package for Maven or for Spring Starter. For Spring, you get Spring Starter. You just import this. You change your configuration or your application properties, depending on where you store this, where you add your Service Bus connection string. You also have to change your provider, which I will show you in a minute. So there's basically two main things that you need to change. And at that point, you just point to Service Bus, and we do all the magic for you. We make sure that everything just works. So like I said, no, nothing else there. But to show you this a little bit better, let's actually just go to a demo, because I think a demo can show this better than I can with these slides. So in the first demo, what we're going to do is just a simple application. So we have a sender that sends something to a queue, and we have a receiver that reads from that queue. And what we're going to do, I will first show you this with ActiveMQ. And then I'm just going to change that connection string and show you how easy it is to move this to Azure Service Bus. And an important thing on this, this is JMS 1.1. So this is with the Service Bus standard. So let's have a look how this looks like. So if I go over here to my demo application, can you read this okay? If not, just shout out. So what I have here, actually, let me just make sure that I have my ActiveMQ running. Yeah, so ActiveMQ is running. So I have my ActiveMQ running here locally. If I go over here, what we'll see if my configuration is I'm pointing to my local host. So this is just ActiveMQ that's running there on the port 61616. And if I go to my JMS connection class, what we'll see here is that I'm using this ActiveMQ in the context factory. And that I'm using over here, let's see which one, here the provider URL. So as you can see, there's a couple of things that are at the moment commented. Those are the things we're going to change later. But first, let's just run this and see if this actually sends something to my queue. So let me start with running my producer. So this is now going to spin up. It will connect to my ActiveMQ, and it will just send a message there. In this case, producer sent hello world. If I go over to my ActiveMQ over here, let's go into this one. There we go, my queues. So if I go to my queue, I should see that in my delivery queue, I have one message pending. So that's the message we just sent in. As you can see, it's now being delivered here. And if I now run my consumer, it should pick this up as well. So let's go to the consumer. And this is going to pick this up. And just to show you that this is actually just JMS, like I'm creating a connection, I'm opening the connection, I'm sending a message, and this is just sending this to that ActiveMQ. Same for my receiver, my consumer, I just create a connection, I open the queue, I get the message, and I display it. So like I said, very simple application, but just to show you like what happens if we now want to move to Service Bus. So of course I want to change my connection string. So I will change this to my connection string over here. As you can see, it's just a standard service bus connection string. Nothing special there. I go to my connection class and then I'm going to change my factory. So I'm going to use this service bus factory now. So the JMS initial context factory over here. I'm going to change my connection string. So that actually uses my service bus connection string in this case, which you can also see here with the SBCF, sorry. And finally, I'm just going to change this part. And as you can see, it's about some very small changes, basically. And now, of course, I could also have this in configuration, which might make it even easier. But just to show you very quickly, like, what does it actually impact? So basically, I just change my connection factory and make sure that I use the right connection string there. So I now change it to Azure Service Bus. So if I now run this, over here. So if I now run this producer, I should also see that it will once again send a message, only instead of going to ActiveMQ, in this case, it will actually go to my service bus. And so if I now go over here to service bus, I can refresh this, there should be no messages here. And if I go over here to my namespace, to the queue, actually it's not in this one. Let me just quickly go over here. Actually, it will take some time to actually get there, but basically what now happened, I can quickly see if I, no, let's, because I need to find which queue it actually was sent to, because I forgot to open that tab. I will just show you in another second for this one, because this will be the next demo. So, but basically what just happened, it was sent to my service bus. It's now stored in service bus. If I now take my consumer, of course, that will also just work as we might all expect, but just to show you my consumer. So it's been sent to service bus. It will retrieve it now from service bus. As you saw, it literally was like, what, a minute of work to actually change this. So it's really easy to actually configure this. Now, like I said, service bus standard only has a subset of features. So it's basically just like we can send, we can receive, but we don't have all of the nice extra features that we want to have. Because those are in JMS 2.0 with the, there we go. Those are here in JMS 2.2 with Service Bus Premium. And so this will be a bit more, we'll be showing off a bit more of the features that we support. But in this case, what we're going to do, we once again have a sender. The first thing we're going to do is just send a message to a topic and then route that to two subscribers. So that will be the first demo. The second demo, we're actually going to do some filtering. So we're going to make sure that message A is sent to the topic A or to subscription A, message B is sent to subscription B. And we're also going to see something with scheduled messages where we can actually say, don't send the message now, but put it on the queue, but only show it after 10 seconds in my case, but it could be 5 minutes, a day, a week, whatever you want. And we're also going to see how we can actually create temporary queues where we can say, okay, I want to have a response back, please send it on this queue, and I will be waiting for that response. So some different patterns here that we're going to see. And of course, once again, we're first going to do this with ActiveMQ, Artemis in this case, because it's JMS 2.0. And then we're going to switch it over to Service Bus to show you that it, once again, it just works without any code changes. So if we go over to my second demo. So, and actually I need to start my Artemis. And why is my Visual Studio Code not working? There we go. So I'm going to stop ActiveMQ, the standard. Yep, I really want that. There we go. And we are going to start Artemis instead. Because like I said, ActiveMQ has ActiveMQ, the normal one for JMS 1, and ActiveMQ Artemis for JMS 2. Run this. So while this is spinning up, we're going back to our code. And in this case, this will be JMS 2. And like I said, the first one will just be sending a message to a topic. So a topic with two subscriptions. We don't set any properties on this topic. So just send it to the topic and go to both subscriptions. So if you go over here to our producer. And then there we go. So it's now going to load this up. It's going to send one message, one message being sent to the order topic. And if we go to Artemis over here, there we go. We will see in Artemis that if I go to my queues, my order topic, so I send it into my order topic and then it's being routed to here to my procurement consumer and to my factory consumer. So there was still a message in there from earlier on, but so now it's now two messages there. So it's now being sent there, routed to subscribers. If I create a consumer, it will pick up those two messages and we'll see that we'll get to four messages. Like I said, there was still one in there. But so my procurement consumer has two messages and my factory consumer. So it's being fanned out to those different subscribers. Now, this is not that exciting yet, but now we can start looking into some of the more advanced scenarios. And let's start with actually doing some filtering. So first we're going to switch to Search Bus just to show you that that works as well. Once again, it's basically just changing my connection string. So change my connection string to Search Bus. Go over here, and as you can see, there's already quite a bit less code, which is nice. So actually, JMS 2.0 did a lot of, made things a lot easier for us. So if we move this one and use this one instead. So once again, it's just like changing that use the right connection string with the right parameters. And if I now create another producer, it will send this now to my Search Bus. And while that is sending, there we go. I will go over here because this one I do have. So if I go to my topics, I go to my order topic. I have some different subscriptions here that we'll see later on. But in this case, it's about the procurement consumer and the factory consumer. Once again, there's some more messages in there because of earlier test runs. But we'll see later on for these that actually will just show you the numbers in there. So if I now create my consumer, it should pick up all those messages that are in there. Restart. And in this case, like I said, it's literally just changing connection string, making sure you use the right provider, and you're done. There we go. So, and actually let me just resend this one because so we can actually see this a bit better. So we come to create new producer. Because like I said, there's now a lot of other messages in there. I just want to show you like it will just create one message in each of these subscriptions. So my consumer again. So I now send one message and I should now receive two messages. And, or did I not stop it before? Anyways, okay, I will, oh, my laptop is, there we go. Don't freeze up, please. okay, I will show you in the next one what happens there. So what we're going to do next is we are going to actually do some filtering. So we are going to say, we are going to send messages. And in this case, we are going to set this region over here. And actually I need this one as well because that's the next one. So we are going to set a property called region. And in this region, we're going to say, okay, this one is for North America and this one is for Europe. So in this case, it's an order. So it needs to be delivered by a certain warehouse. So we want to make sure that that order is actually going to the warehouse that's closest to where we want to deliver this. And we can do this with this set string property over here. Also, we may need to update my consumer, of course. So we are going to remove this. And we are going to start this one. There we go. In this case, I have two consumers. One will be listening on my North American warehouse topic. The other will be listening on my EU topic or subscription. So we run this, run the producer first. So in this case, it's going to send two messages, one for the EU, one for North America. What happened? Oh, wait, I actually need to do this as well. Close these and take these instead. There we go. There we go. So we'll now send that, those two messages, as you can see, one for the NA, one for EU. They are now being stored in Search Bus. So we now go over here, we do F5. we should see that my EU and NA subscriptions will have messages in there. There we go. So I have one in my NA, one in my EU subscription. And if I'm now going to listen to those, what will actually happen is that each of these subscriptions will get the one message for them. And while that is running, there we go. So as you can see, indeed, as expected. And basically what we do is when we create that consumer, we have this message selector here. And the message selector is basically your filtering. So in this case, it says for this subscription, I only want messages with region equals North America. For the other one, I only want messages where region is Europe. Now, for the next one, so we now see, okay, we can actually just send messages to a subscription or a queue. We have seen how we can do routing. Next one, what we'll do is delayed messages. Let's see, yeah, this one. So what we are going to do in this case, we are going to say instead of delivering this message right away, we are going to send it to the queue. So it will be on the queue or on the topic in this case, but it will not be visible for our consumers until a certain time period has elapsed. So in this case, we are going to delay this for 10 seconds. I've put up here delivery, so delay 10 seconds. So I will need to make sure that my consumer is running, which it should still be. So if I create my producer, so this will now send a message with saying, okay, wait for 10 seconds. There we go. And if I now go to my consumer, after 10 seconds, we should now see something coming in here. And this is very nice because it actually allows to say, well, I want you to do something in the future. And there it is, after 10 seconds. Well, I want you to do something in the future, but I don't want to have this logic in my own application where I have to wait with sending or something like that. No, I just want to store it there. And once it's ready for processing, then show it to the consumers and they can then start processing this message. And like I said, in this case, it's 10 seconds, but this could also be hours, days, weeks, whatever you want. The message will just be there. It will be waiting for you. It's not going anywhere. And once it's ready for it to be delivered, it will be placed on the top of the subscription. It will become visible. And then you can process this. This is one that we actually see quite a lot, especially with MQ systems, because a lot of times it will be like, okay, I want you to send an invoice after 5 days or something like that. So you can already create that message, place it there, and then just make sure that after 5 days it's actually being sent out. So we see a lot of different customers that work with this. So next is going to be with temporary queues. And so temporary queues are, so we have the normal queues, durable queues, and a durable queue will just exist. You create a queue and it will just be there. A temporary queue only lives as long as the application lives. So you create a temporary queue, you can use it for, in this case, for example, for getting a return message, a response message, and then after that you can just either throw it away automatically, or you can, it will just go away as soon as your application closes. But it's really just for a short term that you use this. But we still see a lot of customers that actually use this just for saying, okay, I have this queue that belongs with this order. And once I'm done with this specific order, I will just throw away that queue again. So this is something that you also see quite a lot. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to create my producer. Actually, I'm first going to update my consumer and make sure that I update this over here as well. Over here. So remove these, open these, just this, stop this one and update this just to make sure that we are using the right demo. So like I said, in this case, we are going to send a message to our topic. It will be routed to my consumer. And then that consumer will actually see, okay, I need to respond on this. So I have this JMS listener with response, just to show you what this looks like. Let me zoom in a bit. Ooh, a bit, I said. And so what this will do is to actually see, okay, I have received a message and I'm going to acknowledge this. So I'm going to say, okay, I have received a message. It's now completed. I have taken care of this. But then we are going to say, okay, now get the JMS reply too. And the JMS reply to is basically just an address of a temporary queue that's going to be created over here in my producer. And let me just show you. So in my producer, I'm going to create this temporary queue. And I'm going to set that address of that queue in my message. So it will be that reply to. My consumer sees, hey, this is a reply to. I'm going to send my response message on this queue that the sender specified for me. And that way, if I go over here, so if I first start my consumer. And there we go. Almost, there we go. And my producer. So what happens now? My producer sends out a message saying, okay, I want you to do something. And once you're done, I want to actually have an acknowledgement back that you did this. Like maybe a result of something. Maybe you want to have just like an extra acknowledgement. But I want to make sure that I get this back. And did I? Oh, I wait. I've got some stuff here. There you go. Because actually I need to listen for this one as well. So let's try that again. So once again, it's going to send out a message and now it's waiting for the response. So the message has now been sent to my consumer. My consumer now receives the message. It's going to create a response message. And let me just check if, because there we go. And it sends back the response. So as you can see, without setting up any additional infrastructure, I can just say, okay, I want to create this temporary queue. Give me the response there. And that queue is now also gone again. So of course, I still have my other queues or my subscriptions over here. Let me refresh. And just to show you what this looks like we now have these nice names on our subscriptions, and these are our subscriptions that I created my own. By the way, just very quickly, what's also very nice about JMS, it actually creates the entities for you if you don't have them. So for example, if I run my application and my factory consumer did not exist yet, it will actually create that as soon as my code asks for this. But what I want to show you is, let me just rerun this one again, the producer. So it's going to send out the message, and then if I switch back, we will see that there's actually a temporary queue over here. Or at least there might be that it's going too fast, because like I said, it really literally creates it and throws it away again. So it might be that it's now going a bit too fast, yeah. So like I said, it actually throws away after it's been acknowledged. So what I can probably do is just stop my consumer actually. Let me just stop my consumer, because then we should still see it. There you go. Just to show you like what it looks like with a temporary queue. Over here. That's why I didn't see it, because I am in the wrong part. Let me go back over here. This one, because it's actually a queue, so I need to look at my queues and not my subscriptions. And as you can see, there's still some stuff there from, but this will be what a temporary queue looks like. So it's this strange name with GUID in there. And this just basically means, okay, create a queue for me, and once you're done, throw this away. Like I said, there's some demo stuff in there that I should actually have cleaned up. Sorry about that. But so last one. So we have now already seen that we can send messages, receive messages, do routing, do filtering. We've seen that we can do delayed messages, that we can do like a request and response type of pattern. So the last one I want to show you is this large messages. And in this case, you are going to send a message of, I think it's 50 megabytes or something like that. Let me check. 10 megabytes, okay, a little bit less, but 10 megabytes, because we don't want to wait too long. But let me start my consumer. And what this will just do is actually just create a message of 10 megabytes, send it over, and then we'll receive it. So over here. Well, what's nice about this, we can actually go up to 100 megabytes now. And this actually has been asked for quite a while for Service Bus to actually support larger messages than 1 megabyte. Like I said, 100 megabytes is definitely like very large, I would say, but messages of 2, 3, 4 megabytes are quite common, especially when you start talking about XML messages with like large objects. It gets quite large, quite fast. Oh, of
course, I need to do this. Actually, up to here. Oop. There we go. So it's creating that message of 10 megabytes. I'm going to write it out. And I actually need to change this one as well. So remove this one. Remove this one. Open this one. Start my consumer. Start my producer. And so it's now going to create a message of 10 megabytes. It's going to send over the line and on the other. So it's now sending the large message. Takes, I don't know how fast the internet here is. So it's okay. So it's been sent at order topic. And if I go to my consumer, we should see that after a little bit, it will actually receive the message and it can then process this. So like I said, I don't know if the internet is very fast here, but it should be coming soon. In the meanwhile, just come back on this. As you can see, it's like, and this is all running now on SourceBus, by the way. Like the first demo was in Artemis, but then we switched to SourceBus. As you can see, this all just keeps working without any code changes except for the configuration. Okay, I'm not going to wait for this too long. I think everyone will believe that at some point it will actually receive a message. What I do want to show you though is that this is quite bulky, I would say. As you can see, there's quite a bit of, we have to create the context, we have to create the consumers. If we go to the connection factory, they will see that, the message listener, we see that we have to do quite a bit of plumbing to get this all working. So still quite a lot of code that we need to write ourselves. And that will actually be what we will see in the next demo, how Spring Boot helps us to actually clean that up. So this will be a smaller demo again, because the code is pretty much, the idea is pretty much the same. But what we'll do, we have a Spring Boot application. We're going to send a message to a topic. We have two subscribers again, and that we are going to read out. So if I go to demo 3, and the most important part here is that this is just a lot cleaner, a lot easier. The Spring Boot package actually takes care of a lot of plumbing for us. So in this case, I have two endpoints. So I have a user's endpoint and admin's endpoint. And what we do here is we'll do once again, in this case, we send. So we set the property user type. If it's a user, we set user. If it's an admin, then we set admin. And on our receiver, we are going to actually listen for those. As you can see, this is literally like one line of code to create this thing. Where in the other one was like five lines of code plus some extra plumbing around it. It just makes it a lot easier and a lot nicer. So in this case, we're going to basically just say if we receive the user, this is the username. If we receive an admin, this is admin name. Now in this case, I just have one application because I didn't want to split it out and make this in multiple applications because the demo, I think everyone will trust that if I split it out, it will also work. But just to show you, it's a bit easier in this way. And if I go over here, so just waiting for it to start up. Okay, almost there. So if I now send something to this endpoint, so it's running on my local host. So if I do to the user with John Doe, I will see that the message was sent for John Doe. And I also see that I received a user. And once again, this is on a user topic with two subscriptions. So I have a user subscription. I have an admin subscription. So this one is sent to the topic, routed to that user subscription, and being picked up there. Same for the admin. If I send in an admin instead, like this. We'll see that goes to the other queue, other subscription, and being picked up there as an admin. So, and as you can see, this is very clean code, very easy to set up. My own preference is actually Spring Boot, because it just makes it so much cleaner and so much easier. Okay, how are we on time? Yeah, we're plenty on time. Now, with that, we're almost done. I hope that what I showed you today gave you a bit of insights, like how can we use JMS with SourceBus, how easy it is to actually switch over from any other MQ provider, like whether it's ActiveMQ, IBM MQ, whatever. It's literally just changing that configuration. And it's really easy to do this. I do have a couple of takeaways. So first of all, why we think that you should move to Azure SourceBus, and like I said, this is not just me being here as Microsoft, but what I've seen with many different clients, what they see happening. So if you host your own MQ, and we still, like I've worked with a lot of clients that still had that big server there for their IBM MQ or something like that. But the problem, as with anything that you run for yourself, you have to manage your own infrastructure, you have to manage your own operating systems, you do your own patching. Basically, you're still in control of everything, that, or you need to do everything yourself. Of course, you have to pay for the license, if you're, and especially, like I said, IBM MQ is one of the biggest examples of this, which is really expensive, and it doesn't really bring that much more than you get with any other provider, but you pay a lot of money for it. So it can be, it's definitely quite expensive, and also it's quite hard if you want to do like multi-data center or even multi-region. I've known some customers that tried it on their cells, and almost always they failed at it because it's just, unless you're a really big provider, it's really hard to do this properly because there's just so much things that can go wrong. Where, of course, with Azure's Bus, we take a lot of this out of your hands. So it's really easy to set up. It's literally just going to the portal, you create a namespace, you set the amount of MUs, and you, then it's just changing your connection string and just works. Also, we can scale up and scale down very easily. So if you say, well, I might have spiky workloads, you can just set auto scale. It will, you tell it like when it needs to scale, for example, by 75% CPU or 75% of memory usage. It will automatically create a new message unit and will just scale up automatically and also scale down again, so you only pay for what you actually use. The pricing is per hour, so you don't buy an upfront license, you just pay for what you use. You can actually turn it off when you want, but basically just pay per hour per MU. And this last one, this is one that most of my customers were really happy about. Is that high availability, that GDPR is all built in. It's literally just checking a checkbox and it works. And this really is very nice if you want to do that, like that enterprise messaging, because your messages are important. This helps a lot on that. When it comes to management, especially when you're working with Azure, so we basically like focus on if you already are running in Azure and you also want to bring your MQ messages over there. If you use another MQ, of course, you have to integrate that with probably custom codes. Maybe you can use something like Logic Apps or something, but you still have to build it yourself. If you want to do monitoring overall, like there's some different third-party tools that can help you give some insights, but you'll never get the insights that you get when everything is running in Azure itself. Because first of all, like I said, we integrate out of the box with everything in Azure, basically like Azure Functions, Azure Logic Apps, with the Power Platform. It's literally just configuration. You don't need to code anything there. Azure Monitor keeps track of all your different scenarios. It actually shows you like with the map where messages are going. It shows you how different systems are interacting with each other. And you have one holistic view of what's happening in your environment. If you don't trust us, I still know there are some customers out there that think like, hey, but if I store it with Microsoft, Microsoft can see my messages. First of all, not true. We cannot see it. It is encrypted. We cannot decrypt this. But if you still want more security, you can actually bring your own key. So this is just your own key that you make, that you manage. And we can encrypt it. So we do double encryption, which is encrypted by Microsoft itself, but also with your own key. So there's even more security there, so that you definitely know that we can never see into this. By the way, which you already can't, but I know some customers wanted extra security just in case. Of course, we integrate with virtual networks, so you can use private endpoints to actually put this into your own network. So wherever your MQ workloads are, wherever your messaging workloads are, we can integrate with it. And finally, we are fully backed by Azure Active Directory. So you can actually use custom roles, you can use built-in roles to say, I only want you to be able to read messages, write messages, manage my topics, whatever. There's very much granularity in there. And it's all in Active Directory, so you can use your existing users, your existing groups to actually manage that access. So with that, I hope everyone found this interesting. I hope you took something away from this. If you have any questions, I will be here. If you have questions later on, please feel free to contact me. If you have any feedback for Service Bus in general, use it aka.ms link, please. We always want feedback. So with that, I would like to say thank you. Enjoy the rest of the conference. And like I said, if there's any questions, feel free to come up.